time. Her and Emma have been buddies for a long time. Her and Emma have been buddies for a long time. Yeah, I may just play like the second, fourth verse or something. Yeah. Officer Chapel Road, is it? Yeah, yeah. We're up on Perrin, so yes. I pass there on Brandy all the time.
Yeah, still in the same place.
Well, you've been here a long time.
I have. I've been here since. I just celebrated 20 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, been here as the office person for 14.
And you know, it's weird because we're only like, you know, 20, right?
Right.
Yeah, so.
How's that possible?
I know. Hey, how are you?
Good. Enjoyed the singing yesterday.
Oh, thank you.
The Lord be with you. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. My trust is in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God. Welcome to this Good Friday service on this appropriately gloomy day. My name is Jonathan Elms. I'm pastor of Covenant Church and president of the Cookeville Ministerial Alliance. And I want to thank you for gathering with us throughout this week. Especially want to thank our gracious hosts, First Cumberland Presbyterian Church, and their pastor Christian Smith for their hospitality this week. It's just been a delightful time for us to be together. I've been so pleased to see so many people from so many different churches and fellowships getting together and eating. I was impressed by how each day we have rehearsed this fourfold pattern of covenant as we've gathered in Jesus' name, as we've heard the word proclaimed and read and exposited among us, and then also as we've gathered around the table for fellowship to meet one another, and certainly the Lord is in this place. Then as we've gone forward with great expectation for the day and the days to come. And on this day, we pause to reflect. I'm thankful for the musicians who have played. Sandra, thank you for playing again today. Chris is with us. Glenda, thank you for coordinating our songs. And as we turn to When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, it's hymn number 213. I know we'll enter into that as we reflect on the events of that day and its implications for each of us. So I invite you, if you're able and you would like to stand as we sing together, hymn number 213.
Our gospel reading comes from the book of John, the 19th chapter, verses 13 through 42. Pilate brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but this man said, 'I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that's what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciples took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified man broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled, "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on one another whom they have pierced. They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one, because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Word of God for the people of God. Pray with me. Precious Lord, we have journeyed through this holy week. We have heard the jubilations. We have seen the weight of the journey. Today, on this heaviest of days, when the weight was greatest, help us to come into this time with the things that weigh us down. As we look around and we see a world carrying heavy burdens, help us to reach out. Help others leave their burdens buried as well. I ask that you would open our ears, that we would hear the words that you would have us here today, so that our feet might take action in the days to come. We ask this in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Have mercy on us, Lord. Have mercy. Amen. I am so very grateful to be here among you today and honored to be permitted the chance to share a few thoughts with you on this holy, holy day. A colleague of mine used to say, TJ, just two or three pious thoughts, two or three pious thoughts. So here they are, two or three pious thoughts to share on a day so sacred that it's a little scary to preach at all. You'll see a picture up here. I recently ran into a series of paintings by artist Saiger Coder on the Stations of the Cross, also called The Way of the Cross. They're published in his book, The Folly of God, The Journey of the Cross, A Path to Light. Am I doing that? Am I making that noise? Okay. If you're not familiar with it, Stations of the Cross is a devotion which recalls a series of events at the end of Jesus' life, from his condemnation to his burial. Each of 14 stations represents one of those events. The devotion imitates the practice of visiting the places of Jesus' passion in the Holy Land by early Christian pilgrims. Now, one modern practice during Lent is to visit these events through art, music, and prayer, sometimes walking from station to station. Have you done this? Have you done stations? Wonderful meditation. As I was looking through Coder's paintings of the stations, I found myself going back repeatedly to this one, his painting of station number 3, Jesus Falls for the First Time. He's carrying his cross. He has been bound, scourged, and beaten. He falls beneath the terrible weight of the wood. And finally, I noticed what had brought me back again and again to this particular painting. I hope you can see this from where you're sitting. Atop the wood of the cross, we can see the faces of people. People are crowded on top of the cross that Jesus is slowly, painfully carrying through the streets. He's carrying it to the hill upon which he will die. The faces stretch to the end of the frame, suggesting an uncountable number of people. They're all crowded there, adding to the weight, the burden. I looked at the faces. They seemed to me, for the most part, lifeless, maybe even dead. And I thought, ah, Jesus is carrying the burden of their sin. I thought of those people who only days earlier had first welcomed him to Jerusalem with the shout of Hosanna, and then a short time later condemned him with shouts of Crucify him. And then I saw something that took my breath away. See the man in red at the center? You see him? He's wearing eyeglasses. He's wearing glasses, just like we do. The first known use of glasses was in the 13th century. But this guy is wearing them just like we do, just like I do. Now, as most folks in my congregation know, I'm not very visual. I get lost a lot. So maybe you were able to see the contemporary man in this painting long before I did, but it took me a bit. And as Coder's message penetrated my thick head, I touched my own glasses. And in that moment, I recognized myself in this painting. My own weight was part of the massive burden atop the instrument of death of the man who had come to us as Emmanuel, God with us, crushing the one who John in his gospel told us was the very Word of God with the Father in the beginning, the light of the world. And I was ashamed. I was appalled. Not for the first time, of course. Anyone who honestly seeks to live the life of a disciple knows a little something about sin, and I'm no exception. But I have found many ways to submerge that knowledge of my own shortcomings. I dedicate myself to worship and study and good works, and I tell myself, if only I work harder, I can outrun that thing I did or that thing I didn't do. Now you'd think a minister of the church would know better than to believe herself in charge of her own salvation. Apparently not. Recognizing myself in Coder's painting was not where the moment ended. Jesus' face here expresses for me not anguish, not pain, not rejection, not fear, but humble resolve. He does not resent this burden. It does cause him anguish, but he bears it willingly. And if you'll notice, his right arm is straight down to the ground and strong. It does not bend to the weight, but bears it without compromise. It is for this that he was born. At Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples, which we heard about yesterday in a lovely homily by the Reverend Charles McCaskey, Jesus chooses his most important message, the single most critical idea he must leave with his disciples. And of all the things he could speak about, he gives them a single, simple word to guide them through the long, uncertain days to come and beyond. That word is love. That word is to love one another as he has loved them. That word is the salvation of all creation depends upon love. And for five chapters in John's gospel, Jesus speaks of almost nothing else. I don't want to paint with too broad a brush, but my observation over many years has been that many of us in the Western world, particularly Americans of privilege, I count myself among them, perhaps you do too. I can't remember ever in my life having to wonder where my next meal was coming from, can you? Many of us are afflicted with a sometimes dangerous condition. I think of it as the John Wayne philosophy. We are independent. we are self-sufficient. We take care of ourselves, and not only ourselves, but we take care of everybody else in our orbit. You recognizing anybody in this? Do you know anybody like this? I'm not going to ask how many people this represents. And we certainly don't ask anyone else for anything, especially help. It grates on us. It feels weak. We admire and we reward people who live by this philosophy. It feels like a virtue. Sometimes it is, but not always. It can put distance between us and others, many times even those closest to us. It can keep us from being vulnerable to others, keep us from adequately receiving love, not only from other people, but also from God. I did not weep from shame when I recognized my face in Coder's painting. I did weep, however, when I recognized that I was precisely where I was supposed to be. The great gift of the cross is gratitude. I cannot bring about my own salvation. It is only by the grace of God, only by a love so powerful that it sees only the precious child he intended, that I can hope one day to climb down from atop that cross and enter the kingdom of God. Amen.
Thank you, TJ. I see myself in the image. I hear myself in your message. It's convicting. Each day this week, we've had someone speak to us about the offering that's being received and is being split between the PEP Foundation, which is the backpack food program, and Food to the Rescue, which provides supplemental nutrition to Putnam County school students during all of the breaks, spring, fall, winter, and summer. And I'm thankful for all of you who have contributed to that. Christian told me yesterday he's been keeping up with the total each day. I'm humbled that we have raised $3,315 as of that. So I think if we dig deep today, we can make it an even $10,000. No, that's wonderful. And every cent of that will go to feed literally hungry children. Our church, Covenant Church, we take care of the backpacks for Avery Trace Middle School. And we've just seen those consistently tick up since the pandemic lockdown. It's just increased. Different small groups in our church, we call them missional communities, have taken turns packing those. Our group took a couple of months ago. I expected to go out and pack 100. We packed 300 because we go through them so often. The counselors and the principals call. We need more. And I know my heart is like yours. We'll provide all that's needed. You've heard personal testimonies of our interactions with children who are those children who receive them, who need that. And so often I hear folks say, well, you know, they have resources in their homes or social services. But when you're a middle schooler, you don't know how to navigate that. You don't know how to help that. And there may be resources in the home. It's up to the parents to decide how those are allocated. It's not their responsibility. And so many times, these children, like the ones I mentioned, they're eating three meals a day. What are they eating today? School's out. Tomorrow, Sunday. What are they eating Monday when school's out? Mom or dad are at work. And so these meals provide things that they can fix, they're easy to fix, they're pop tops, they don't have to be cooked. It's meals and food that's easy for them. There's a couple of breakfasts, a couple of lunches, a couple of dinners, some snacks, things we take for granted. You know, I like to kind of graze all day. But I hear these children, they can't. So for us to provide that for them, it empowers them to feed themselves, to care for their siblings. I just want to commend you on your gifts this week. And we'll just continue to support these vital programs in our Putnam County Schools. So thank you for that. I want to thank each of the churches that have provided food for us this week. My own church, Covenant Church, First Cumberland Press, First Presbyterian, St. Michael's, and today kind of being underwritten by Double Springs Presbyterian and Robinson Chapel Presbyterian churches. And so I'm so grateful for that. Not only did they provide us some delicious food, but this wonderful opportunity to sit in fellowship and get to know each other. And I have feasted on that as well. Will you bow with me as we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for how we've heard the painful story of how you've provided something we often don't even know we need. Yet we are desperate for it, living bread. And so, Lord, we commend these gifts to you, Lord, that it purchases very real bread, feeds hungry lives. Lord, you've called us to care for the least among us. And so doing, we care for you. So, Lord, in these moments, these tender moments, we offer these gifts. Lord, our worship to you, our stewardship of what you've given us, our response to your abundant goodness. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
It has been so awesome to have you guys with us this week. We have so been happy to be able to begin anew this tradition of meeting together. And as Jonathan said, one of the great parts has been able to be at the table together. As we leave this place, we do invite you to lunch. If you cannot stay with us, in the room just over to this side, you will find sandwiches, chips, cookies, drinks. Please feel free to take whatever you like. on your way back to work or home, and just dine with us in spirit. If you can dine with us in person, I think maybe it slowed down on the rain. We are across the parking lot in our Family Life Center. There's plenty of seats. We would love for you to spend the, again, we're worshiping here tonight, so we're not going anywhere. We got all day. Hang out with us and just fellowship together. Before we leave, as always, would you stand and receive the benediction? May the love and the mercy of God the Father, the peace and forgiveness of His Son, Jesus Christ, the fellowship and the guidance of the Holy Spirit be with you today and every day as we leave here going back to our individual churches, but always being united as a community of faith. Amen.